the people who actually work in the labs do everything? Do you think they're
in rural ARP, Texas 8th grade science teacher Jarvie Stroupe integrates digital technologies with traditional pencil, paper, and lab techniques to give her students a special end-of-year practical lesson in how the scientific method is used in forensics and help them prepare for the thought process they'll need in the science lab as freshmen in high school.
Do you remember what we did on Monday? Anybody tell me? Robbie?
We did the blood stuff that we...
Blood spatters, right.
Now, my class today, the first period class, has a lot of differentiated learners in there. They are not, I have some highs, I have some lows, as far as just how fast they grasp information.
All right, can you guys look up there? I'm going to show you quick. We're going to be talking about CSI and what they actually do.
Her mother reported her missing about 10 days ago.
Was your victim from a small town?
Ely, Nevada. She came to Vegas to be a model.
Today I wanted them to understand that Hollywood's great and it's fun to watch, but the real world is different because a lot of people think they want to go into forensics for their career and because of what they see on TV. And I wanted to try to keep that interest level, but still show them the reality of that's not what it's all about.
Do you think every lab, every forensics lab has all that cool stuff that you can just throw up in the air and they can just start moving? And
so it just ties in their interest. It gets them kind of fired up for next year that they still like science. I've got to keep that interest level because a lot of children come into science and go, I can't do science. It scares me. I don't know it. Kind of like technology used to do to me. And you've got to keep them going.
Using their shared netbooks and the internet, the students were asked to draw charts of the methods investigators use to search a crime scene for clues.
Paper, you are going to draw and label the five types of search patterns.
Technology does not mean plugging them in front of something and then letting them go. When you're using technology, the last thing you do is sit down. Because the more technology you use, the more questions they have. And so that stimulates more conversation and more teaching, which is what we're shooting for. That's what we want.
Fingerprints, hairs, those are all things we've talked about. Think outside the box a little bit, can we?
Diaries.
Oh, good one, diaries.
The technologies definitely tie into the group settings. One thing, because we are not quite to that point where we have a one-on-one situation with the technology. But also, it's a brainstorming situation. If you have a computer in the middle of three different students, they're going to start talking about what's on that screen, and they're going to start interacting. So the technology helps in that area.
After additional internet research and discussion, each group reported on their findings by posting comments on the teacher's classroom blog.
List and find some of the things that you think are the most interesting, and I want you to attach that to a comment section on the blog. Okay?
Today, using the blog, it's always nice because the students that need their information repeated numerous times, they can go and look at it without me having to be right there to repeat it for them over and over. So that gives them that added edge where they're not embarrassed to have to raise their hand and ask again. So it's really neat that they can go to the blog for that.
The netbooks, along with the document camera and projector, also help the students compare their own fingerprints to known standards. And once again, they use the classroom blog to report what they've found out.
Two main things you guys have kept bringing up today, fingerprints and DNA, fingerprints and DNA.
It's always fun just to kind of find things like looking at your own fingerprint. It's something simple, you can do that in first grade, but the eighth graders still enjoy it because it's something that they can look at and they can hold and touch and they can get up and move around and do. Because we often do a little bit of research and then we'll do a short experiment. A lot of my experiments are not real long like they would be in high school. They're just short demonstrations, but they usually do the hands-on experiments. And then I usually try to tie it into how they're using that into the real world, like we did today using the research and the netbooks. And when we got the projectors in our rooms, that was just amazing for science.
All right, bonus question. Who can tell me what DNA stands for?
Deoxyribonucleic acid.
Everybody together.
I love the creative flow. That's the most exciting part of teaching to me. And then the material science is so fun to teach.
Did you guys, what color is black? Well, of course it is. Why would you ask such a silly question such as that, Miss Jarvie? Aha, well, we're going to find out what color is black.
A simple paper chromatography demonstration using traditional lab techniques, in combination with a document camera and projector, allowed the students to see how DNA sequencing is done.
And if I keep the kids moving, they usually stay engaged. And you cannot teach science by sitting and doing nothing. Science is a process. It is not just a class. It's a process. And if you don't learn the processing skills, then they're never going to understand science.
And they will split out differently according to your DNA. And then they can find a match. So eventually this color should look the same as the match on another piece of paper. Does that make sense to you? So even though this is...
I think it's the engagement factor, that you can just get them that quick wow factor that I used to not have, like the little CSI clip I used today.
Any tips on how to conduct this search?
Easy. Think like a bear.